there's two paths all the time. And this gets kind of difficult to grab because you start to think, well, how does this movie leading me? What about this song? And if you just would kind of come with me on this journey for a second and entertain what John's writing here, is that there really is only two spirits in the world. Ones that are leading you to Jesus and ones that are leading you away from Jesus. And you think about your life and the pace of that, and it's very, very challenging. But it relates to my story because I remember growing up thinking, okay, it's MBA or bust. Now, that may be funny for a 5'6 white kid, but I'm telling you, we grew up thinking we were going to make it to the league. And dreams become to get shattered a little bit. I remember first time, you know, where I'm not the fastest on the court anymore. You start playing in AAU and different things, and you're not hooping on the same level. And the next thing I know, people could actually dunk, and I'm hitting the net, right? And then I'm introduced at 15 years old. We're partying over the summer, and some guys say, hey, you want to smoke weed? I remember thinking, oh, this will never be me. Yo, I'm straight. And then slowly but surely, one interaction led to me getting kicked off the varsity basketball team senior year, and I was doing jail time on weekends at Mason High School right outside of East Lansing here. And you can imagine that, 4.0 student, and then now on weekends, because I'd gotten in trouble over the summer, doing jail time. You know, a lot of attention was shifted towards me. And I remember outside of high school, I'm sitting in my room one time. These guys bring these friends over. This dude's about 6'4". He's got this jacket on. It's a little awkward, to say the least. It's not that cold out. I remember looking at him in the face and said, hey, why are you wearing the jacket? He goes, oh, it's cold out. Not feeling that good. Oh, okay. I remember walking to the bathroom, come back in the room, and he gets right in front of my face. He pulls out a .45 and he puts it right to my face, and he says, we'll be taking everything. And I remember that moment when you have a gun pointed to your face. It's real. Like, I remember thinking, I never thought that my life would get to this point. That no one thought that this three-letter word that nobody likes to talk about anymore, and it's not sex, it's sin, would lead me to this place of darkness. Now I'm confronted with my life. And he's like, we're going to take everything. I'm thinking, you can have it all. So he's grabbing, this is back in Nintendo 64. So he's grabbing, somebody's like, what? He's that old? Yeah, Nintendo 64, they're grabbing everything, and he backs out of the sliding glass door, and they leave. And I remember my heart just racing, we sat down. My parents didn't raise me like that. School didn't teach me like that. But just some bad decisions over time led me to a situation that was so atrocious. You know what it really comes down to? It's the four-letter word. It's love. What did I love most? When my world became crashing down, what I loved was sports, which led to attention, which led to affirmation, because we all long to belong. Everybody wants to know that their name is heard. Every girl wants the attention. Every guy wants to know that he's the man. And I'm telling you, at some point, we have to redefine what our win is. I remember it was a few years later where I was introduced to Jesus in a whole new setting. Kind of the end of yourself is where God can begin many times. You know, college is a very unique setting for you guys because you can multiply your future, or you can find yourself stagnant, or you can find yourself on the retreat operating with what the enemy wants for your life. He does not want you whole, does not want you happy, does not want you healthy, does not want you firm and to know that you're a king's kid, that you're royalty. You know, John gets this oh so well. And he writes in verse 19, he says, it's not that we loved. It's that we loved because he first loved us. I love the gospel so much, the good news of Jesus, and I'm here tonight just to kind of inject some passion in your life. We come here on a Tuesday night, leaving my kids so my wife can tuck them into bed and get some pointers from Phil and Julie, so thank you, because they got four kids, they're older, so I'm trying to listen and learn. And the reason I'm here tonight is because I believe this good news is so powerful, it's worth every ounce and every focus of your attention. Because when you and me die, newsflash, we're dead forever. The stakes are really high. A game that lasts for a moment, right? You know? The contest that lasts for a moment. Practice that lasts for a moment. And it's hard to get that when we're young. It really is. But as you get older, you see some of your closest friends now entering eternity. Life happens. It gets real. Been impacted by the thought of this, that life has a way of breaking us all. If we let the brokenness lead us to the grace of God, then we find true freedom that this world could never offer. The true win tonight really is a life fully devoted and surrendered to God. And this is not easy. When you talk about Acts 2, where you at, right there? I love Acts 2 because it's the action of God. Acts 2 is so remarkable to me because a lot of times we care what people think, if we're honest, right? We care, we come into a room, we could even be with all of our friends but feel still all alone. Proverbs 18:1 says this, that whoever isolates himself goes against all sound judgment. When we isolate, man, the enemy loves it. Oh, I'm just all alone. And what do? We retreat to social media. We retreat to these type of attention from all the wrong sources and places because it's the college life, right? Yep. I was talking to somebody the other day on campus and they said, you know, it's just, I'm living that college life, I'm getting drunk, and you know, it's just what I have to do. I'm thinking, is that what you have to do? You know, a frog will be in water and it'll allow itself to be boiled to death if just slowly the temperature's turned up to the point of boiling, it won't jump out. I wonder tonight, how many of us, the water's just getting turned up a little slowly, and then we're being boiled to death spiritually. I know that God wants to set a lot of us free. And freedom really comes from being defined by one person alone. One person's victory. And that's Jesus, y'all. Jesus is so powerful. I think that tonight where this lands is, when you really think about community, are people leading us closer to Jesus, or are they leading us further away? Is the settings that we're in, the devices that we have, are they being used to grow us? We're entering spring. I have had the opportunity now to travel the country and even some international countries making hip-hop music. And making hip-hop music, it's okay, somebody could laugh like he makes hip-hop music. Making hip-hop music has been such an amazing platform to share the gospel, because it's a lot different than my six-year-old experience going with grandma. But sharing the gospel through music, so many times though, you're getting tons of attention. You come off stage, you're like, hey, yo, I like that, I did like it. I remember thinking, okay, who am I really doing this for? Seeing thousands of people respond to the gospel, like, I'm in, I want this Jesus thing. You know, a lot of people say, I want to come, I want to play, I want practice. But as you know, over time, you get to find out who's really in it, because over a period of the time, you'll find out who gets exposed and who doesn't, right? I mean, it's just how it happens, who's really with you. And this is what's so powerful, because you and me, we will always let each other down. But the grace of Jesus Christ, he first loved us. I really believe the answer tonight to all of our problems is this. What love are we letting define us? And really state what makes us our worth. It is so contrary to the setting that you're in. And I empathize deeply with it tonight. I almost feel like I'm pleading a little bit. Because think of your worldview. I gotta study, I gotta get a test, and I'm gonna be graded upon that. I gotta go to practice, and I'm gonna have some type of match or contest or game, and we won or we lost. But how do you live this mindset that I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me? Philippians 4:13. You know what's so interesting about that passage? Y'all still with me today?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. You know what's so interesting about that passage? Is that it says just a couple verses before that, whether I have a lot or I have nothing, whether I'm well fed or I'm not, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. That's written by the Apostle Paul, who was a superhero of superheroes. He was a winner of winners, and he says that my identity is rubbish compared to how awesome Jesus Christ is. See, what happens is this. This is why we need each other so desperately. Because we're reminding each other that we can't do this thing alone, and we're not victorious in our own strength. Doing these concerts and going from city to city, one thing I found was when I would come back to the same city, I would see so many new faces. And I remember asking pastors that say, hey, where'd those faces go? What about, you know, Timmy? I remember talking to him at the altar. Oh, yeah, he's not here anymore. Why not? What about Sarah? She was so awesome. I remember she was sharing at the altar about how she was abused and now Jesus is changing her life. Ah, oh, she's not here anymore. I mean, what happened? You know, in Matthew 13, it talks about when the gospel's shared, there's different type of soils that sets in. We're in spring. Here we come. So things are going to grow. Agricultural college, here we are. It's beautiful. You get to see well manicured and prepared what it looks like when vegetation and the land is being properly tended to. Ooh, it's beautiful. But when it's not, when it's just left to decay, it's like on rocky soil, it doesn't look so pretty. In our lives, if we're honest, sometimes we're not letting Jesus tend us the way, and we're getting affirmation from all the wrong places, and our soil is just so mucky and cruddy, and we don't even know anything anymore, and it takes a crisis to get back on track. So I hope tonight is one of these nights where those that are on track, man, you rejoice. Those that aren't on track, you say, oh, I got to get in the game. Those that are maybe far from God, they say, today, I can't do this without Jesus making me brand new. At these concerts, what we decided was this. That it's not enough just to see somebody get spiritually reborn and make spiritual orphans everywhere you go. It would haunt me to think that somebody would have this life-changing moment and not be connected to a team or a family. God never meant for me and you, and here's the pitch, He never meant for me and you to live life alone. If you had to think in your mind for a moment, who's the strongest spiritual friend you know that's a follower of Jesus Christ? Do everything to get around them. What's the greatest leader you know that you could follow them? Do everything to get around them. What's the Bible that when you think about somebody who knows it, do everything to get around them? What's the studies you hear about? And I know it's challenging with schedules and all kinds of things, but I'm telling you, sin is so mucky. It devours our identity and our worth to the point to where we can't even hold our head up high anymore. I love a quote by John Piper. It says that we are most satisfied when God is most glorified. In Psalm 115, if you had to take this note, I would take this note. I'd go home and I'd really ask yourself this deep question, because it's a question I'm asking myself tonight. Psalm 115:1, it says, not to us, O Lord. I love this because it's not about us. It's not about us. I've been in enough settings, and I don't know your pain, so I'm only sharing some of mine. And you probably have pain, and all of our pain looks differently. And some of the pain that I've experienced now, getting to one walk through people through their worst moments and some of their best moments. But, you know, when you start doing a funeral for your friend right next to you that you grew up with in your lockers right next to each other who took his own life because depression hit him so hard, and you walk into the hospital at Sparrow on the sixth floor, you see his parents and you see his body being held alive so his organs can be donated before he enters eternity. And when you have moments like that, it does something to you to say, when you get an opportunity, you tell somebody that eternity matters most. That's the greatest win ever. And you can say, oh, well, man, this guy is super intense, Jerome. What is up? And I would say, no. This message is so beautiful. It's worth all of our attention. And it never has to feel like we have to. This is what's so beautiful about it. Verse 1, it says this, not to us, O Lord, not to us, but to your name give glory for the sake of your steadfast love and your faithfulness. I love that language. Your steadfast love and your faithfulness. My steadfast love? Your steadfast love? No. You and me, we can't ever win with God. Jesus can. The gospel in a kind of condensed version is this, simply. You and me, no matter the best we could ever be, will never be good enough. Our righteousness is but filthy rags to the Lord. And then on our worst day, we're never too far away from the grace and the new gift of Jesus Christ. That scripture is pretty clear. When you and me are walking this earth, we're dead in our sin. But when we give our lives to Jesus Christ, we become brand new, born again. It's kind of a miracle. It's the greatest miracle that ever take place. You'll hear people say, let's pray for signs and wonders. A life devoted in Jesus is the greatest sign and wonder. Have you put your faith in Jesus? I hope tonight's your night. And if you're already in Jesus, I hope tonight you're inspired by John, because in 1 John 4, he talks about this. You want to walk in this love? You have to abide in this love. Now the word abide is simply this. Receive. To let him be your home. Not let him come to the front porch. Okay, God, I want to get cleaned up for you. You know what's so interesting, pastoring, is the number one question we get about people that want to attend? We're talking, and this is what I wear, okay? And here's what they always ask, what do I have to wear to come? Like, interesting. Because you know what that implies? Our worldview is a preconceived notion that I have to get cleaned up to meet Jesus. And it's kind of masked under, well, I want to respect you. I want to respect the church. And No, wait. And Jesus shows up in our classrooms. He shows up in settings like tonight. He shows up in your huddle. He shows up in your small group. He's in your dorm, but you got to let him in. He wants you to be in him, abiding in him. And here's the most beautiful part when we receive that. That's why the grace of God is just so powerful, y'all. When you're in him, you bear fruit that lasts. The fruit that lasts is peace, patience, kindness, joy, forgiveness, long-suffering. It's how somebody can endure right now in a third world country. For them, you know, talking about this message, it could cost them their life. For them, when they're baptized, I think this is good, because we need a global perspective sometimes. When they get baptized, it literally means that they've cut off from all their old relationships and now they're walking with Jesus. They believe that Acts is so real, it changes every area of our lives. So here we go. We're about to enter spring breaks coming, right? We got spring grown, you know, midterms. You got all this summer's here. You got to look good, get right, six pack, got to get the bikini, you know, selfies coming out. You got Tinder requests. You got Snapchats. You got filters, and all these things. Oh, what do we do? It's so hard. I get it. It's hard. But sometimes you just got to run from it because it leads to death. Leads to death, y'all. Leads to death. And understand this. I'm just preaching to myself tonight. We just all happen to be in the same room. Because the same grace I'm talking about is the same grace I need every day. And what's so beautiful about it is this. It's there to receive every single morning. And so the bold question we kind of land with is, God, how do I give you glory? What gives you glory? That really is the most motivating thing you could ever think of. What's the why behind this? We get the opportunity to talk to inner city kids, and they're really good at slacking sometimes. They are. Because they figured out, well, you tell me why. It's not a good answer, so I'm trying to tell them, well, you got to do schoolwork, and I don't care. I'm hustling on the side. Oh, yeah, but you, it's hard to tell them a why because life has already beat them up. When they understand that there's a master, they start to recognize I'm responsible to the one who set me free. That's the greatest why you'll ever find. Is that Jesus is your answer. He's your solution. He's your freedom. He's your source. He's your identity. He's your love. He's your peace. He's your mercy. And that's so girls don't have to hold their head down like they don't have confidence that you're a king's kid and you know whose you are, and that makes you important and worth something. Not because you're worth something, but because Jesus is worth it all, and he said you're worth something now. You see, and we're found in him. We're going to take 3 minutes. We're going to watch a video. And I think this song is my favorite. We're going to live holy. Holy is just a word, you know, what does that mean? Holy means we're going to live set apart, that we're in the world, but we're not of it. Doesn't matter where we go. We could go to the craziest club tonight. Go, hey, we filled with the Holy Spirit. We love you. Now we're going to need each other, right? Because we're going to get drained, beat down. Oh, I'm discouraged. I want to just fall back into my old patterns. That's why there's a new rhythm, new practice, new life, new scripture, new community, right? Check this song out. As we make war in this season for what's most true, purity, holiness, and love.
I hear so many Christians murmuring about their imperfections and their failures and their addictions and their shortcomings. And I see so little war. Murmur, murmur, murmur. Why am I this way? Make war!
war against lust, against pride, against all of the wickedness. We have to make war. Because I'm telling you, the enemy, he's going to make war. And here's how we make war. We make war by just letting Jesus be the Lord of our lives and the guide of our lives. And that his love, who first loved us, we can love people. You know what perfect love does? It casts out fear. Fear comes. It's a real thing. You know that guy who helped me at gunpoint? I saw him a few years later, after Jesus had transformed my life. I was picking up a friend from the bar at 2 in the morning. And I remember praying in my car. I said, God, use me tonight. Walk inside. My friend's down $600. He's like, I got a double or nothing. Yo, let's go. And he's like, no. I look outside. I see this guy. I'm like, I recognize him. It's just me and him in the parking lot. I'm like, that's the guy who held me at gunpoint. I hadn't seen him since. You can imagine that moment. Your heart starts racing, right? He's on the phone. I go up to him. I recognize it. I got to go. I got to talk to him. And he looks at me kind of crazy. And I go to grab his hand. And he looked like he was about to reach for something. He goes, I got to go. And he's looking. He goes, I grabbed his hand. I said, hey, my name's Jerome. You held me at gunpoint in my bedroom 4 years ago. Jesus changed my life, and I want to tell you that he can forgive you, and he loves you tonight, too. And he looked at me, and he started bawling his eyes out. See, I say that illustration to this. The same setting that used to take me away from God, that when I gave my life fully to God, start getting rooted in community and around the right people, that I can still go back. It didn't mean that I don't. I can still go back to the same settings. But this time, I'm the off. We prayed together in the parking lot that night. He gave his life to Jesus Christ, and we've got to see each other in the city over time. And just recently saw him. He said, hey, I'm going to stop by City Life. I thought it was just a cool story of how God can use anybody in any situation.